So remember, too, that that was in Java, and it was really quick. There was no server configuration. There was very little development configuration. Just installed Eclipse and installed a plugin, and it's pretty much ready to go. Also notice that I didn't have to write any JavaScript XHR calls. That's because I'm using Google Web Toolkit, and it'll handle the communication between the client and the server for me. So what App Engine does on the back end, making server-side tasks easier, Google Web Toolkit does on the front end, making client-side coding and development easier as well. So if we can go back to slides. So they told me I needed an architecture diagram. So it's Google Web Toolkit in the front and App Engine in the back. Now, I want to talk about two features that are coming up in Google Web Toolkit. We're optimistic that HTML5 is going to bring some sanity to the browser world, yet you're still going to have to develop for multiple browsers. Now, Google Web Toolkit's inherently designed to work across browsers, handling the differences for you. So you write your user interface in Java, and then the compiler is going to handle the compiling to the optimized, appropriate JavaScript for each environment. But right now, there's a wrinkle in that development flow. We encourage people to use CSS, because it's a powerful way to style your apps, but if you're familiar with this, you'll also know it's frustratingly inconsistent. I see some of you relate. So it's times like these when you want to use Firebug to figure out what the heck's going on. Now, here's the wrinkle. Because we have real-time Java debugging in Google Web Toolkit using a special browser, it's meant you had to compile to JavaScript first, then take that, go view that in Firefox, and then look at Firebug. And then so we had an extra step in there. Well, I'm happy to say in the next version of Google Web Toolkit, you'll no longer have to do that. You'll be able to debug directly in the browser. It's also not just Firefox, it's any browser. So let me show you a quick demo of what that looks like. So I'm going to go back to the project that I just created. And I'm going to change the launch configuration to use the new plugin. So we'll take this out here. So this is going to start up the plugin infrastructure. And I'm going to close down Nightly and start up the other version of Firefox we have here, because that's what my plugin is installed on. Now I can navigate to my local server. And you'll notice that I'm passing in a special query parameter so that we know it's coming from the hosted mode. And you can see this is the app that I just had. And so now I can use Firebug and inspect like you're used to. OK, well, that doesn't seem too special. But remember that what I have on the back end is still Java. So you can see this is Java that we're generating here. I can make that change, go back to Firefox. I'm not using the special browser here. Click Refresh. And then I should be able to inspect that. Well, let's see if we refresh again. Or sometimes it helps to restart your server. So let's do that. All right. So we've got that running. And make sure I didn't cache. So this is going to make the development cycle a lot faster. It's also going to work on multiple browsers as well. So all the major browsers have plugins. And there we go. There we can see some changes. And it'll also work with other plugins as well. Now, I want to talk about one more feature that we're really excited about in the next version of Google Web Toolkit. With all this HTML5 functionality, you're going to find yourself writing rich user interfaces. And if you've built apps like that before, really large JavaScript, Ajax apps, you'll know that your JavaScript code base is going to grow. And it's going to grow a lot. If we can go back to slides, please. It's going to grow a lot as you add more functionality. And that, in turn, means your users are going to wait, and they're going to wait, and they're going to wait for your application to finish loading. So you need a way to split up all those JavaScript files across multiple files so your user can get started with your application without having to wait for it. However, manually splitting JavaScript can be very tedious. You have to get the dependencies correct. It takes a long time. And you really, it's not something you want to do on a Friday night. So that's why in the next version of Google Web Toolkit, we're going to help you out with that and do it for you with something called developer-guided code splitting, also known as run async. Now, with run async, what you do is specify in your code somewhere that you're willing to accept a short pause in exchange for the compiler being able to functionally fragment your code base. So what this means is I can download code after the initial download. Imagine you have a settings page. It's not it's rarely used, not used on startup at least. Well, there's no reason to download that code with your initial download. Instead, you'd set a run async split point, then allow that code to download in the background after your user is up and running. OK, you're saying, Andrew, that's great in theory, but does it really work? Well, I'd like to leave you with some metrics from a real-world application that's using run async. This is an application we'll talk more about tomorrow. This is a graph during development of the size of the JavaScript code base. So it quickly grew to 1.4 megabytes as they added more functionality to the UI. So that's a lot of code to download on initial download. Now, after run async, the initial download was decreased to 200K, which can then be decreased another 80K to about another 80K when you gzip it. So 1.4 megabytes to 200 kilobytes, so that's about a 7x decrease. It's going to load a lot faster. And the best part is they didn't have to worry about the dependencies themselves. The compiler looked at their code base and handled all that for them. So these are just a few of the features that we're adding to Google Web Toolkit. We're going to be talking a lot more about the future and the present with both App Engine and Google Web Toolkit over the next few days. So please stop by and join us. Thank you. Thank you.
Great job, guys. And as you can see, these are the URLs where you can go to learn more or attend any of the sessions. Of course, we are very, very happy at Google to see the developer adoption of Google services. You go to a web page and you see someone who's incorporated Google YouTube or Google News or Google Video or even Google Search on their page, and it delights us. You know, we have over 60 APIs that we make available to developers. In fact, we're very proud to announce today that we have crossed the 4 billion API threshold. That's 4 billion API calls every day coming into Google. That's even a big number for us. And so thank you for your support. Thank you for enhancing your apps with Google services. Of course, we're not satisfied. We want to do more to make your web apps better and make the web even richer. And we looked at one of our most successful models, and that's AdSense. There are literally hundreds of thousands of sites that use AdSense. And they get those Google ads on their page by nothing more than including a little bit of JavaScript. And so we asked ourselves, why couldn't we take that approach for everything we were doing? Why not make our other services that easy to incorporate into your applications? To demonstrate a brand new developer product for you, I'd like to invite up DeWitt Clinton to walk you through that. DeWitt, please.
Hey, welcome. Thank you, Vic. Hi. Today, I'm very pleased to introduce Google Web Elements. Google Web Elements bring Google products to your website using simple copy and paste. We were inspired by the embeddable YouTube video and AdSense and asked ourselves, could we apply this approach to more products? Today, I'm going to demonstrate adding Google News and Google Maps and Google Search to a website using Google Web Elements. Let's get started. Here's a simple website we put together, standard two-column layout, like something you'd find on Blogger or WordPress or your own site. It looks pretty good, but I think we can make it more dynamic. I'd like to pull in headline news from Google News, and I'll do that with a Google Web Element. I go to google.com/webelements, and I select the news element. And here I can choose from headlines from technology, sports, politics, or enter my own. I'll enter Google, and I'll fit it to my site. And I copy the code, and I go to the HTML of my site, and I find the right place, and I hit paste. When I go back to the page and refresh, Google News is already live. I'd like to add now a map to Moscone and the developer conference. So I go to google.com/webelements. I go to the maps element. I type in Moscone Center. And we're here for Google I/O. And I like the terrain view. And again, I copy the code, I go to my template,